To explore living wall ecology in a harsh environment, the University of Texas at Austin and the Lady Bird Johnson Wildflower Center partnered in a project that takes education outside the walls. Planted in June 2016, its roots started with an idea.
The project really started in 2010 when I became a faculty member in the School of Architecture here in Austin and came across a wonderful man named Mark Simmons, who is the Director of Ecology at the Wildflower Center, the Lady Bird Johnson Wildflower Center. And he was directing and doing some major research on green roofs. And I was super excited to see that that was taking place at the Wildflower Center. And my thinking was, why aren't we doing this in the vertical dimension with architecture? And I approached Mark and said, look, I've got some sketches and I've got ideas about the architecture side to this, but my love of plants only goes so far. And so we started imagining what that architecture and ecology incubator could be like. And then wanting it to be around the School of Architecture in some capacity, because from my perspective, that's where we're trying to change the thinking, is that we're not just building with steel and concrete and glass anymore. We're building with plants and trying to integrate landscape in a different way in the vertical dimension. We wanted to replicate or test the western facade that is the most challenging. And so this is the northwest corner of the Goldsmith Hall for the UT Architecture School.
We planted all the units at the Wildflower Center with our volunteers and with our staff time and with our space, which was, it was really beautiful and fun to do, because a lot of the volunteers hadn't, they were very curious about this particular pot we were using and why. And so there was a lot of questions, which I think was really, really lovely.
Danelle designed and fabricated the 148 plant cells on a 10 by 25 foot structure.
It is sized to be not only the right sort of capacity for a plant to be able to grow into, it's not huge because it needs to be able to be held up by a wall.
Our pilot project is actually cantilevered out of the ground. It's not touching Goldsmith Hall because, in effect, it is temporary. It's just a folded thin metal plate that has this hexagonal honeycomb pattern cut out of it.
The soil blend's also a result of years of testing.
The soil that we use at the Wildflower Center, what we found that if there's particulates and like sized the same amount that kind of pack in there, they hold a lot of heat. So we've developed a media that has different particulate sizes, and so air can move through it easily and the plant can actually root easily, but it still holds on to water. It has a certain amount of organic material in it, but it's not an organic material that's going to break down immediately. It's a slower material that'll break down slowly. We actually use things like pecan husks. Then when we installed it in the wall, we had one or two big rain events. It's been a struggle for some of our species. False aloe is just not liking the rain at all. We also put the wall on the most extreme condition, which is on a west-facing surface. So getting a very specialist plant might not be the best thing to do for this particular situation. So choosing the plants for here, we looked at ecoregions around Texas. And some of the ecoregions, we even choose areas that were out in the Trans-Pecos, because cities tend to be 5 to 10 degrees hotter than the surrounding like rural areas. So we knew we might have to have some hardier, heat tolerant species on this wall. So that's what we looked at. We looked at species in the Edwards Plateau and the Balcones Canyonlands. We looked also to the Chihuahuan Desert for a few different things. And then there's a few things from the east as well and in the Blackland Prairie zones. A lot of the grasses we chose are very hardy and kind of generalists. So they live in many different habitats across Texas. Two of those being side oats grama, which is the Texas state grass. And then we also used little bluestem. Some of the other species that are really tidy and nice are red yucca, which just keeps its form. It's not overly fussy. It hasn't lost a lot of dead material. We're doing seasonal maintenance trips where we go in and we record everything we do in each pot. I know how much dead biomass needs to be picked from these things. I know the amount of time it takes for one person to kind of handle this whole particular site, so that if we were to create a larger wall in the future will know what type of time it takes to put into this particular system. We're also keeping soil moisture, pH, and salinity information. So let's talk a little bit about irrigation too. So one of the reasons we do a certain amount of soil volume is so that the plant can hold moisture within that volume.
Each component has its own irrigation drip line, which is in some effect redundant because we could imagine that one could drip all the way down, but we really want to understand at a granular level what water is being given to each plant and the variety of plants that we've chosen and how we can reduce water usage as much as possible. It's a research side to what we're doing that's been directed by Marcus Hoag from facilities. He's really in charge of the smart watering system initiative that's on campus, and so any water that is going into the wall is being data driven and data monitored, and it doesn't get watered on days that it's raining. We're monitoring the water distribution, the thermal heat gain in both the front and the back of the wall, and in between, we're monitoring motion and light, and so temperatures of the day, and everything to do with the environment that is very local here is all being captured. We're not only considering the benefits of plants for such a living wall system, but also the habitats that we've included on the four corners of the wall.
We have four different habitat units on this particular wall, and they're all for different species. Two of them, we got really specific with how we designed them. One of them was a wren house. The other thing that we did specifically for a particular species is the native bee house.
And then the cork habitat that you see in the corner is the bask. We're just providing a kind of scratching exfoliation surface that lizards like. There are actually sort of insects and bees and bugs sort of adapting to what is here, because before there was just stone and concrete, you know, which is nice. But, you know, I think that we've given them a bit of relief that's different from what they might find out here in the lawn and oak tree scenario. People who have nothing to do with architecture or the Wildflower Center are stopping and asking, what is this? And why is it here? And what is it made of? And so we're sparking a lot of interest from people who just were unaware. You know, as much as we think that living walls are becoming ubiquitous, there are some out there that this is completely new. And I'm happy that we're changing the way people think about architecture and think about our future development.